Beth Guide, and I'm with a company called SEO 411. We've been teaching internet and online marketing classes now for the better part of 15 years. We've worked with several agencies in the area, and we've tried to pick some topics. We do a lot of in-person training for this. So what I've done now is I'm going ahead and we went ahead and put this right out on the internet, right out in live virtual. So I'm going to start today. My today's topic is going to be Google Analytics. I'm going to go through it with you on almost all parts of it. If we have questions, I just need you guys to jump up and just let me know what question you have. And then we can go from there. So I went to, the first thing you have to do is go to Google Analytics. So it's google.com/analytics, and it will bring you to a sign-in page just like this. And you can go ahead and sign in. I'm going to go ahead and sign in. And click the sign-in button, and I am in the right account. I'm going to go to LED Spot. I'm gonna use this LED Spot one as a as my base to talk with, and I want to go through each parts of the screen, each parts of where they are, and how to set some of this stuff up and what we've done. Let me close some of these windows. Oh, the one thing I wanted to tell you from a housekeeping perspective is I went ahead and made a centralized page for the classes, all the classes that we're doing. Everything's running virtually right now, and I hooked up a video archive. So the classes are here in the video archive. There's been two classes so far since we've all been sent home. Both of them are listed here in this video archive. I'm going to start uploading the older material, but these two classes are from the last 2 weeks. So if you've missed a class, here's where they both are. So you have that. The other thing that I did is I've listed all the calls, or excuse me, all the websites, the classes with the Zoom info is there for each one of them. We're doing one tonight through HCC. The HCC class, just so you know, has 340 some odd people registered to it. You're all welcome to attend it. It's going to be on LinkedIn and Facebook profiles. So we're going to talk about how to use them and how to use them in a pandemic to make our life work better. And then the other thing I'm looking to do, and I'm not promising this, is that I'm looking to teach a WordPress class the last month, last week of the month. That'll be about 8 hours working on WordPress and how do we do and what do we do and what do I do and how do I build a page of WordPress and how do I set up a page and every other WordPress class question I've ever heard. So we're doing all of these things. We're doing them all virtually, and we're trying to help everybody we can just stay in best shape possible. Let me see. So if you go, I was telling Bob that if you put in internetmarketingcliniChouston.com, you will be redirected to this page. It's also under this classes tab up under here. But this is going to be the centralized hub for all these classes, so that it's easy to follow and not jumping all over the place, and you know what we're doing, when we're doing it, and have the Zoom logins for each and every one of these classes at your fingertips, because I think that's an important piece of this. So internetmarketingclinic.com for those of you that don't know. All right, so now let's come back to Google Analytics. So I'm using this website as my delimiter because it's got a lot of bells and whistles running on it, and I want to start to go through this. The first thing that I'm going to tell you that you need to do, though, is make sure that you have Google Analytics added to your website and add the code to the website. So for those of you that are using WordPress, like I've kind of asked you guys to do, what I will tell you is there's some software out there that's called Monster Insight. It's a plugin. And let me log into the back end, the LED Spot here, and I'll show you. Let's do it from both sides. All right. So if I come in the back here, it's called Monster Insight. I have it on my dashboard generating this chart here for you. And I have a pro version. You're not required to have a pro version, but I do have a pro version on this website. By using this particular plugin, basically what it asks you is, what is your name? What is your login for your domain name at Google? And it allows you an easy setup without any plugin knowledge needed. So the good news is you can add Google Analytics without any complication just simply by using this plugin. If you go to your admin section once you log in and you want to add the tracking info, you're going to get the tracking info here out of the tracking code section, and it's going to pull up a page and it's going to give you the tracking code. This is what, if you were going to put it in manually and not use Monster Insights, this is where you would go to get the code to pull into your website and put on your website. So there's two different ways to do it. One is through a plugin that you use your username and password and you select off a list. The other way to do it is to get the code and put it in the header of your website. If I had to guess, most of you are going to use the plugin. Those of you with places like my Wix, Weebly, Web, Squarespace, I see like Lance is here, so I'm going to kind of address that. The Squarespace people, you can put this code in there, but it's the basic building block on how we are going to get our analytics and how to find out what's happening on our website. So the first thing I want to explain, though, is what is the difference between analytics and statistics? Those are two entirely different concepts, okay? Analytics sort of analyzes data, where statistics is just raw data, okay? So there's two ways to pull information in, not from Google Analytics, but to understand what's going on. One is a raw log file, and because I'm at my house, I can actually, I've never been able to show this before because I've never been to where I can get a server log on something, but if you'll hold on a second, I will do this really quickly. Bet y'all didn't know I knew how to do this. Okay, so this is the access log of this website. So when people go to this website, if you look here in this, let me make this window just a little bit bigger so you can all see it. This is what's happening when people go to the website. So if I open another browser, I go to the website. It should print it out and hit it and go there. If it was, it didn't go there. Oh, because it's the old site. Oh, no, there it is. So you see right there, it's coming in, it's looking, it's putting some information there for us. Let me do this. Because I forgot we have this. Okay, so here's the other thing it does. It dumps out all the tracks, all the traffic, all the people. And you can actually, if you have access to your log, you can actually see the raw visitors and the traffic as it's processing through. So I always think that's a good thing to do. You'll see it all load in. I just hit the parking lot page. You'll notice the parking lot page is now what's done. So it's a little.
Hey, Beth.
Yeah.
Hey, I think your screen isn't showing the right.
Oh, you're not able to see. Okay, good deal. Hold on. Let me see if I can move this over to the right window. Hold on. Thank you, Lance. I appreciate it. Okay, so hold on a second. I'm glad you said that because this is important for you guys to see the difference. Let me see if I can just change this. Stop sharing this window. Start sharing. I'm glad you said that. Actually, I'm just going to do my whole desktop and we're going to just go the heck with it. All right. So you see, this is the shell. So you can see that now, right?
Yeah, a bunch of code, I guess.
All right. So this looks like a bunch of gibberish, but what it actually is the raw server log. It's telling me what the search string is, what people are putting in, where they're coming from, how it's working, and what's happening. This site is very busy, so therefore you're going to see this go through in big fits and spits like this with these big chunks of data scrolling by in them. if I was to sit here and watch this, I could tell you where people are going, what they're doing. And I have a log parsing software. Some of you guys have seen that log parsing software through things like, I think it's Webalizer that comes with basic hosting accounts. So you'll be able to see that log, it parses the log, and the numbers and the values are much different. So that's why there's a lot of inconsistencies in the analytics home or the analytics screen, because they're taking pieces of that log file and producing analytical data, not statistical data. So I just need you to understand. If I had to say, I'm going to tell you right now that I think this LED spot does over 1 million page views a month. They throw a lot of that data out because it's repeat visitors. Some of it is bots and so on and so forth. But on average, that thing does over 1 million people a month. All right. So I'm going to come in. So my first panel that you come to once you log in and hook your stuff up is it gives you an overview. What I will tell you is that every website that we have is down on traffic. I think there's a rumor out on the street that there's a pandemic somewhere. And all these sites, pretty much the traffic's gone down and there's not as much going on. This particular business has been interesting to me because although the traffic went down, the quality of the leads has been much better. So we've actually had higher sales since the pandemic started than we did on a regular basis. And the traffic, although it's down, seems to be better traffic. They mean Google does things in a 7-day increment. I usually like to evaluate things over the course of a 30-day period. So when I do it over a 30-day period, you'll see it still says we're down 10% in the over where we were, but I'm kind of okay with that, just simply because the world we live in right now is a little bizarre. I think that's probably the kindest way to say that at this point. So I can see the users. They say we've had 9,700 users. They say those users are the real users. What it also does, because I have this turned on through Monster Insight, is it actually gives me a revenue total. So over the last 30 days, this website's made about 50 grand. And it says my conversion rate is 0.075. I'm very unhappy with that conversion rate. And I'm gonna need to go through and start to look at that. And this is how many different sessions. So a user is a person, a session is somebody that's a user that comes in and they start a session. If you leave and you come back, you're another session. So just understand the relationship to that, that the user is the unique person, the session is the non-unique person. I'm going to expand this menu out and it's going to go ahead and it's going to give me some more detailed information. I've had 2,000 sessions. I've had 2,300 unique people. I've had 9,000 page views. Again, this is a 7-day total, so I'm going to go up to the tippy top of my screen and I am going to make it 30 days. So that would be here. So we're going to watch these numbers go. So my 10,000 users have accessed 38,000 pages. And what's good to my mind is that they're using about 4 pages per debt per session. So every time they come, they seem to use a total of four pages, and they're staying for 2 minutes. So they're really shopping. They're using the website properly. It has a low bounce rate, and I was kind of talking to Tom about this yesterday. I'm actually not really super happy that the bounce rate is as low as it is, because it seems to me to be artificially low, that people are coming in and not bouncing off. I would rather see that to be a little bit closer to 35-40%. So at some point I'm going to come back to that and say, hey, wait up a minute, what's going on here? Are we, why is this a little bit on the low side, or what you would expect a regular website to be? I mean, we can't be perfect 100% of the time that we have a 23% bounce rate. And then our new sessions is up 131%. So it was, we're rocking right along here. And we did really well. It gives me a breakout based on language. It tells me country. It tells me what city. So I can go to city, and it'll tell us our most busiest or our most visited city. Ironically, even though we're based in Houston, Houston is number three. And people that don't have a location or location services turned on are the number one person. The other interesting thing that I always look for is what is the browser that they're using. So we're making sure we're in compliance. So of course, Chrome is number one, Safari number two. The other thing this will tell me is what percentage is mobile. So this is the first chance that I can say, let's jump into this and add a segment. This add a segment is a very important feature to me in analytics because it allows me to add a special delimiter to see where it goes up against the whole. So when I'm analyzing a website and I'm seeing where it's going, I'll add a segment and say, hey, I want to see how many pages have mobile users out of this. So out of all my users, what percentage are mobile and tablet users? And you'll see it throws it out for me that I can see now what percentage is what. So this website has an interesting situation because it's mostly desktops that are accessing it. Now, I could make two inferences from this because I only have a 30% mobile thing percentage. I'm going to say most of this that people buy are people that are contractors and they use their desktop at their office. But the other thing that I'm going to kick out to you is that since this pandemic started, we may find that mobile usage is down because I haven't touched a mobile device since I've been home in the last 4 weeks other than my phone. I've been using my desktop. I've been using my computer. If I'm going to do something, I'm more likely to go to it than I am to use a tablet. So I think there's been, because we're all stuck in our houses, there's been a little bit of a change. So if that was my premise, what would I do to decide or try to think about what I was going to do to see if that was true? Well, what I would do is I would go back over here and I'd say, let's compare this to our previous year. And what it'll do is it'll go back to March of 2019 and it'll give it to us and it'll tell us what the difference is. And what it's saying is that mobile sessions are actually down between last year and this year. That we had more mobile sessions last year this time than we did this year. So what that tells me from when I look at it is that the home segment has changed somewhat how the people are utilizing their devices and what device they're using. They're actually using their desktops again, that it's not necessarily just a paperweight. But that's how I would proof that against one over the other. It's not as dramatic of a difference as I would have thought, though. What I will say is I expected this to be a lot more than just 2%, but it's 2% right now. So that's that story. Let's get out of here. Let's turn all of this off.
What about adding organic on there?
I can do that. Okay, so if I want to do that, I can add an organic segment to that. So let's go down here and we'll leave on our all users tag. And then what we'll do is we'll come down here and we'll add our organic tag and we'll hit apply. And what it's going to tell me is that my organic traffic is up by 1% over last year. I don't have any paid ads on this website, so I would not expect there to be much of a variation. That anybody that's coming back from me is coming back because they knew us from previous and coming back that way. Somebody like Trips to Italy has the ads on or had the ads on. And they had a different percentage. So we still were getting, it was about a 70-30 split if I went organic versus not. This site doesn't have that. On that subject, I'm just going to throw this out there. I want everybody to kind of hear this loud and clear. For the last year and a half, people have been saying to me, you know, why bother with SEO? It's old school. We don't need to do this, blah, 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 blah. And I kept saying, you know, I don't care about all the paid things that you're doing, but you always need to make sure that you have a good strong organic presence because people are going to be looking for you in the results. Well, what I have learned in this, everybody is, I don't know what we all are right now, but in this pandemic situation is because everybody has had to jettison every extra dollar that they've had. The ad revenue has been shut down. Everybody has shut their ads off. Those of us that were floating along with really good SEO, those people are still making sales. Those people are still running their businesses. And they may have missed a beat here and there, but for the most part, they're in a whole lot better shape than the people that were buying ads or the people that put no effort into their SEO. SEO is free in the sense that if you do it, your time is worth something, but you don't have an out of pocket. You may have to pay somebody to do it, but those results are permanent. So in this situation, those results are staying. They're there. They're working. They're doing everything that they need to do and still driving a business. So this business has gone up in the pandemic and not gone down because it's 100 solely reliant on SEO business. And before I knew there was going to be a pandemic, I made some changes to this website, and the changes that I made to it saw it just blossom and go through the roof. So I'm very pleased with everything that's happened, but this is the argument of why SEO is really and should be on everybody's radar. It should not be poo-pooed. And at the end of the day, although it's longer, it's the more sustainable track to be on. And in fact, I probably am going to write a blog post on this because I was getting tired of hearing the people that, well, I get leads from paid search. They're not leads that usually close, but I get leads. So those people are in a lot more trouble now because they were dependent on ads than the people that went down the SEO road. So I'm off my soapbox, but I wanted to clarify that. So SEO's up on this thing. The website's done. I can segment and out anything I want in this, and we can kind of go down it if you want. You can see, did I make a purchase? It will tell me organic traffic and was a purchase made. I can look at those two items and compare one against the other. So it tells me that, let's see, where is it? I'm trying to look at, let me shut off the last year. I think that's the bigger, that's why we've got so many lines and dots going on here. Okay, so I have had 8,000 users, 6,500 of them were organic, 133 of them have made a purchase. I've had 10,000 users, 5,900 became organic, 25 made a purchase. It gives me what those are. So I can take any type of data and compare it to any other type of data. What I will tell you is when this pandemic's over, I expect this website to be in being with maybe 600 or 700 people a day, easy. So just to put that out there. And I would, for such a niche, I would be thrilled with that level of traffic. So, this is an important set of screens because this helps us to understand the overview or the makeup of our audience and who's in it. So that's the first little overview section of this up here of what I'm looking at. When I come in and I look at this is, I always check this here first. I always love this real-time report because it tells me who's on the website and what they're looking at. And when you go into that particular part of the report, it tells you where that person is in the country. It tells you what they are. This person, I guess, is named Melissa, and she must be logged into something that we're able to tell who she actually is. That's kind of interesting. Normally, you don't see it that way. Normally, you just see the city that it's attached to. So that's a good thing. This one, it tells me a little bit about these people. One of them came in off a website, off Google itself. It came in under not provided. So that means that came off a web search. My guess is the web search came from over here under this commercial landscape lighting and inbound ground pole search. When I see something like that, I go back and go search, check my search results then and go see where that is and what that is. So just so you understand, I kind of work this from both sides of this. When I sit down and I do Google Analytics on somebody and I'm looking and I see something like this, I'm very intrigued about how they got to me. And then I go look and start to go figure out what the what that path was. But this is because I named my pages right. I know what page they're on. And I then can start to see. So here's another one. This person came in. See, it came in off of this. I guarantee you we're number one on soccer field lighting if I had to guess. I shouldn't say I guarantee, but S-O-C-C-O-E-R field lighting. We're number two. Here we are right here. So that's somebody puts that in. They're searching for soccer field lighting, and here we are down here. After the pandemic, at some point, I may decide to put us in here, but I'm not quite there yet, just because the graphics piece of that, but that's a paid search function, but that's just a side thought of my head. But you see, now we've had, since we went away, we've had two more people come into this website, and you can see they're not repetitive. They're three different parts of the country, or four different parts of the country, rather, and then one's on mountings, one's on transformers, one's on soccer field, and one's on photometric lighting. So we've had you know, a good little bit of a pop of people. I can kind of see what's going on. The other thing this solves for me is my website working? I get people sometimes that it's not, if they say, my website's down. And then I'm like, no, it's not. But this is a good way for you to check and make sure that everything's working. As long as you see people coming and going on your website, you know you've done something right. So just kind of throw that one out sideways at you. Okay, so this here, they give me some insights of what they think has happened and what they see. Good news, you're up on revenue. But what they don't know is that I went ahead and actually just flipped this website into WordPress. So I don't know if I'm really up on revenue or not. I just made it so they can start counting. But that's that story. How do I acquire users? I always look at this as a measure of success, and I have to tell you why I look at this. And I'm not super happy about this at the moment. This website was garnering about 350 organic searches a day. It's down to 245. I am going to say that changed with the pandemic. It was the pandemic that kind of did this. But I'm going to ask this question. If you saw 247 on one day and 324 on the other, what would you do? Anybody want to tell me why I even point that out? I unmuted you so you can all speak.
What's the question again?
Okay, my question is, I see a gap in these 2 days. So yesterday I had 247 yesterday. I don't even know what day it is. The 6th, I had 247 organic searches. Yesterday, I had 234 organic searches. Why does that number pique my curiosity? Okay, why it piques my curiosity is I need to go figure out what terms I picked up that allowed the traffic to bump up by 50 organic searches a day.
Okay.
So that's what I'm going to do now when we get offline, is at some point I'm going to go see what I can figure out as to what happened yesterday. What term did I pick up? Did I move up on something? Because I keep making adjustments on this website, trying to push it forward. So conversely, if it went down, I would have to go, hey, what changes did I make to this website that caused it to go down? So there is the opposite side of that. So when you see these, but you have to watch that. You have to watch this pretty closely to pick up a tick like that. Now let's go back, and I'm going to go 90 days.
Hey, Beth.
Yes.
Beth, can you explain the difference what social, referral, organic search, and direct mean?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. So, and I just gave a 90 day. So you can see, this was up to 2,000 organic. This is on a week now. So just understand that number jumped up a lot. So I had 2,000 organic searches here, 2,000, 2,000. But you see, as the pandemic came in, you start to see it drifting downward, okay? So we went from 2,000 in a week to only 1,200 the first week of the pandemic, 1,400, 1,600, and now everybody's kind of coming back to normal. what that is, Lance, for you is that the social is anything that we pull off a social media property of any type, okay? A referral is if I am on another website. So let's say I was on house.com, that referral might be high. And we'll go into that when I get into audiences and we'll go see what those referral properties are. Direct is somebody that types it directly in a browser. And then of course, organic is somebody that does a search and organically lands on a site. So there is that piece of that going on. So each of those are other is they just can't quantify it. It just is a nothing, I guess is the best way to say that. But on my acquisition report, I'm going to go pull that out. I can go in this. Let's go see referrers here for a second. I want to see what's in there. So this is interesting. We got some off the Houston West Chamber of Commerce. We got some off of an Xfinity search engine. I own this property and Baidu is a China search engine. So it racks all of those up. So there's a very long story to this, but I also own this residential landscape lighting and design. And what we did was spin that website down and take it and put it over to our new site, which is that LED spot. So I continue to get monthly traffic from big residential until that winds itself all the way down. So that doesn't surprise me. What does surprise me is this Baidu at 107 that we're actually pulling up in China on a Chinese search engine. I'm really kind of surprised by that. And you also can see we've got China Bing, we've got AOL, we've got somebody that was sent something in Google Mail. So that's another version of a, so you can see these are all just properties that are sending. That's what that referral piece is. Let's come back. Let me go backwards. Are you going to go backwards? Yes. Go back one more. Arg. I hate when it does this. All right, let's come back here. Let's come back here. Let's go to my acquisition report. Okay. The other thing you can see is organic search is just killing it. Organic search is what drives this website. If it didn't have it, it wouldn't survive. But look, I'm getting almost 7,500 organic searches a month on this. This also is the direct type ins, but you can see that organic's just killing it versus the rest of every other aspect of this website. And then there's social. I'm sure we got a couple from Facebook and, you know, just a little Pinterest, because we've got people putting up pictures and then pulling through to Facebook or to our website. I will tell you that I have seen websites that the Pinterest and the Google images are actually running the website, that the people are finding the images and that's how they're actually coming through and finding the people to do stuff with. So I'm surprised that we have as much of a Pinterest as we do, but that's good. I'm happy about that. So we've talked about this box here. This is sort of my favorite box because it tells me on a daily basis really quickly how good I'm doing. Because if this box fails, the whole rest of the website fails. That's kind of how I feel about that. The next thing is, and this is important to know. So when we analyze a website and we look at a website of what it's doing, and what this is why this really has some value, okay? Let me make this bigger, so make sure we've got the right sample. And you see I keep pulling that sample back to days because I don't think 7 days a page makes, okay? But you see this page here, it says sports lighting, basketball court lighting, okay? I'd like to know what this page is because I want to see what this page is doing and if it's kind of making us any money, because you see the value of this page is only $1.30. It doesn't really have, and what it's doing is it's taking the dollar amount out of Monster Insights and it's saying, what is the value of each of those? What is that page going to earn per visit? So the home page is leading the pack, of course, but this basketball court page, I'm going to go look at it because I want to go see what this page looks like. Let me see if I can kick that out. Yeah. So this is my basketball court page. And what you will notice with this is this page, I'm not too sure I'm happy with, because I don't even know that these look like basketball courts. They look like CAD drawings of basketball courts. So I'm going to see what I can do to make these look a little bit better, because I know I have a lot of people coming in on that page. But I think that that page itself is, we also have 25% of people at exit on that page and don't go forward. So I'm a little concerned. I'm going to talk to them about getting some real basketball pitcher lights here, and see what we can do to maybe kind of push that along and see if we can't get that to go a little bit better. I also don't like this piece of it either, that they're all, because I don't know about you, but that doesn't look like a basketball court to me. In fact, I don't even know what that looks like. Maybe it looks like it. I think of basketball courts, I guess I think of Toyota Center. There was a place we used to go to back when we could go places called Toyota Center. So anyway, I've got to make jokes about it. I'm going to cry, I think. All right. So I'm not super-duper happy with these numbers on this page. I want this page to convert better. I need to figure out what the purpose of these people are. But I'm starting to look at these pages, and I use my pages report to go down each and every page I have so that I understand what that page is, what it's doing. So let me show you my tennis court page. We've kind of talked about this before. This tennis court page has had a lot of, that's a different tennis court page. It's going to make a liar out of me. Usually the tennis court page that comes up in the top of the pages report is the one that has the ad that I had to put the, I had to put an ad on it. So here, let me show you the page that normally comes up. Let's come back. See this page here, what we found is it was getting all the tennis court searches. So we put an ad in the middle of the page so that people knew, click, so you can go browse your full line of tennis court lighting instead of, but it seems like Google has rechanged the search and pushed that tennis court lighting in directly at the tennis court lighting page. So that's a good thing. But we go through each and every one of these to see what's on a page and see what that page looks like. And I'm going to do this on the commercial lighting page too, because that one's getting a lot of traffic also. So the good news is they're giving me landing pages that have products on them. I'll give them all the credit in the world. That's kind of really kind of amazing. Usually they don't do that. They go with the article pages, but it looks like they've made a jump on this website and jumped into where they're giving me product pages. But I go through each and every one of those and make sure. We have a divorce lawyer, and he was getting a whole pile of traffic on child support. So we put ads up that said, you know, we put, and I'm calling them ads, but we put graphics up basically. It says, hey, if you need your child support reamended, we're the people, call us. So we kind of monetized that page by putting some information on it so that people would do business with us. So this is your pages report. That's very important. Your user activity, that kind of just gives you a running average over the last 30 days. Again, we see a downward trend because of, and it really was abrupt that it started downward from the point of the pandemic forward. If I pull it out 90 days, I think what you're going to see. This is where I flipped the site to WordPress, okay? So I changed the site over 100% to WordPress on February 1st, and you can see it was ascending, and then we hit the pandemic and the bottom fell out a little bit. So I think once the pandemic's past us and life gets back to whatever the new normal is, we're going to find out that this site's going to kind of keep going up and we're going to be a very happy bunch of people. We talked about the type of device. It's important to know. So you're optimizing for the device, 60% of the desktop. This website looks great on the desktop. It's fine on mobile too, but it's optimized really for the desktop. That's a good thing. Some of you, and I would have to guess somebody like Lance would probably have way higher on a mobile or a tablet than he would on the desktop, because most people looking for fun things are not really running around on desktops to do that. Last but not least, I ended up, we put in Monster Insights will collect the data on what we sell now. So I can kind of come down this and see how many of something we've sold in the last 7 days. And you can see these wall packs, you know, we sold a wall pack. It's a unique purchase. We've sold 8 separate putting greens to 8 second people. So somebody has their hand up. Person with hand ups, go ahead. Do you not have the ability to talk? Let me see. Everybody should be unmuted. Hold on, give me a second. Allowed to talk. A whole bunch of yous I didn't get to allow to talk. Okay, you're unmuted, so go ahead and talk away. What's up?
Hi, Beth. I just wanted to know what page value means. And then a while back, you talked about 0.75 conversion rate, and you said you were not happy about it. I was wondering what that.
Okay. All right. I got you. Okay. So the page is, what is the monetary value of the page or the transaction or the sale versus the value of the overall website? So this page has had 130 views. It comes back in and it figures out what the value is based on how much I've sold off that page. So if somebody pushes a cart on that page and adds something to a cart and checks out, they're saying, hey, that page had XYZ amount of money spent off that page and that user made some. You see this bullet light one has a page value of, so we must have sold a lot more bullet lights, and it's probably down here in this somewhere. Let me see. I can't make this go out further. Is this 7 days? That's 7 days. What I'm not happy with is the conversion rate on this site as a whole, and I need to look at it. And the reason why is when people are coming in, they are not converting or making a sale. So although we are getting a bunch of traffic, the sales piece of this website is only up to 0.7%. So out of all the people that come to my website over the course of a month, only less than 1% of that traffic converts into a sale. Ideally, I'd like to see that 2%, 3%, or 4%. And it's because something is not right. And I haven't looked at it this closely. So just understand, we just flipped this to WordPress and then everybody went home. But if I come up to here, this page here is a problem. Okay. Anybody want to tell me why this page is a problem?
One is not formatted right.
Okay. It's because I'm logged in, but yeah, it is a little bit constricted. But why else is it not a good? What else is wrong with this page? Okay. How am I going to buy something off this page? Anybody got a clue? Anybody know what we charge for sports field lighting? So I need to go back and I need to look at this page and I need to put something on this page that allows me to make a sale off this page, because there's nothing to instruct the user. So again, what I did is I put in sports field lighting. See that soccer field lighting? I come down here. They give me this page. And this page seems to have no direction on what I'm supposed to do on it. So that's a lost visit. Now, we already talked about that this page had a lot of visitors on it. So I need to now go back and say, hey, what am I going to do to this page to make this work? Now, let's go to Access Fixtures just for a second and see. So I come to their page. I have a button for lighting. I have a thing that says contact this guy. I have a picture that looks like a soccer field. I have a whole bunch of things here that talk about what we need to do. And then I have a shop for the lights, shop for the packages, shop for. Now, what's interesting is this is a sports soccer field and it's talking about tennis courts. So their relationship is off. These should have been shop for soccer fields and shop, you know, that kind of stuff, not necessarily. But the ability to shop, at least I have a big thing here that says shop, APTI sports lighting. So when I come in on a soccer lighting page, His is not much better, I've got to say. So that's a win for us. If I can go fix this, they too have issues. But that's how you have to start to think about these things. And what are we going to do? There's no prices on this page. So the user is going to just think about what you do yourself. You come into a page and you bounce right out just simply because there's nothing on the page. There's nothing there to tell you what to do or what to buy or what you're supposed to do. Here, let's see what Lightpulse Plus does. Yeah, they're another one that don't tell me how much this is, aren't they? All right, everybody's kind of sucking on this today. I will say, I'm going to tell you all, they're all sucking. So what that tells me is that I can have a really quick win, because if I start getting people right to where they can go buy a soccer field light right off my soccer field light page, that may help me up my game. What I'm going to do is this. This is, and let me see where we are here, because this may or may not work. Okay, so light poles, all right? That's a really big term, and I want to show you a couple things here on this light pole search term, all right? Where we're getting the most amount of traffic from is right here. These are our light poles. So when I click on the picture, there are pictures. I'm going to try and figure out which one is which. That's somebody put that size. They're going to make a liar out of me, and we're not going to be there, right? Here we are. That one there is our light pole. So when I come to it, it says concrete light poles, boom, and now I can go and go right to it. So that image search is a really big deal, and people are kind of using this right off the side of that to go make that search. I have to look at all of these things, but you asked me about conversions. Yeah, I wouldn't buy a darn thing off that webpage, off that search. And that's why this thing has problems in a few spots. So little by little, I'm going to go chase down every one of these and say, okay, is this a user-friendly page? What is the search term? How are people getting to this term, this page? And what can I do to improve it to make somebody want to buy something off of us? See, like this one here, it's got zero sales. So why is these two tennis court light pages have no sales on them? That's the kind of questions I'm asking myself when I look at this kind of stuff and I go, well, what am I going to do to make an improvement? So I start to go look at all of that on a much grander scale to go figure out where we are, what we're doing, and what I can do, because each page needs to be analyzed to that level. It's an exercise in psychology, but you have to know this. The LED spot website, I think, has 30 some thousand pages on it. So I can't just go say, hey, here's a page, let me go pick it and I'm going to go find it. So, I hope that answers your question. And let me kind of come back over to here and go back. So does anybody else have any questions before I kind of get off this home screen thing that you land on? I'm going to take the silence as a no. All right. Okay. Try to make sure everybody has the, everybody's talking is permitted, right? Nope. Not talk.
I might have missed this earlier. I like at the bottom where you list the pages, I clicked on that to bring mine up. But the first page on mine, it just has the forward slash.
All right, that's your home page. And that may or may not be a good thing. And let me tell you why. Because ideally, I want people landing on the pages for what they're looking for. If you have to land on somebody's home page, chances are you then have to navigate to the next part of that. And I don't know that I'm too happy when somebody, I want to give somebody the search, the result based on what they're searching. I don't want them to have to go scouring my site to go figure out where I'm supposed to go and what I'm supposed to do. You know how I talk about the hierarchy of a website and how you put that website together? That's what governs how these pages are ranked. And because that's what's governing it, that's what's going to help you get out to where your homepage is not always the most traffic site on a page on the website. So cool, Byron, you good?
That's good.
All right. Okay. All right, onward and upward. So when I come to, we kind of talked through the real time already. I have an audience, I have the audience thing, and I find this to be very interesting. So let's kind of go to the audience in the overview section. And we already kind of looked at this screen, but there's a whole lot more information that we need that we can gain out of all of this. And I kind of want to talk down that a minute. This is people that come back and forth to the website. So they're saying, is somebody active one day? Are they active 7 days? If I go to 14 days, you'll start to see that there's a huge drop off. Now, what I will tell you is that on a lighting site, I would not expect a lot of daily and repetitive activity, okay? If you are a cooking blog, I would want to look out over that. But, so it depends on what your website does to see how repetitive somebody is or is not coming back in and out of the website. The lifetime value is, what is the lifetime value of a customer that comes in? We get this question quite a lot. It's easier with an e-com site than it is a regular site. And I'm going to try to explain this best as all. Way back 150 gazillion years ago, and it really does feel like we're in Jurassic time as I look backwards, Web Hosting for Idiots was ranked number one on the search engines. And what we ended up having was all these people flood in the door. We got, we would get 10, 15, 20 accounts signed up a day. Some of those people are still here. So if my acquisition of that person was nothing because I didn't pay an ad for them, and they paid me since 2003, $100 a year, that customer has a really good lifetime, long-term lifetime. My lifetime at my company at the SEO, at SEO 411, I have really high lifetimes because our people get here and they don't leave. So what is my cost of acquisition? What are they cost? Okay. So the organic, we've already determined that it has no cost. However, I'm going to say something a little bit different on this, okay? What happens if I'm trying to pay $2,000 a month and that's what I have? Then that acquisition cost starts to change because now there is a $2,000 spend that's applied to that has to be divided out and into all of these numbers. So just understand, you should have an idea of what customer acquisition is and what it costs you to procure a customer. And then what is the lifetime value of that customer? So somebody like Lance, correct me if I'm wrong, and probably you too, Virginia, do you not, you people come in from you, do they come back to you or are you one-offs for the most part?
I have some repeat customers.
Huh?
I have repeat customers.
You have a lot. Do you have a lot of repeat customers or a few repeat customers?
Just a few.
Go ahead.
I have the repeat customers and the referrals. I mean, I don't think my website does anything. That's what I've been learning.
Well, that's because you went and put it in the wrong spot. So that's a whole different story. Your website's not working for you now because you haven't looked at making it work for you. But you have to look at your client cost of acquisition based on all channels. So you run ads. I know you have stuff at HAR. I mean, you run ads in the local Observer here or whatever that paper is now. I don't even know what its name is anymore because I just keep rolling over it with my car. All that kind of stuff. What you have to look at all of your spend to come up with your cost of client acquisition. What I will tell you is that when we worked for Constellation Energy, and this was sort of an interesting story because they brought us in to fix some things, which we did. And then they went, hey, can you make this rank organically for us? And we're like, yeah, that's like shooting ducks in a pond. I took their cost of client acquisition from just under $1,000 down to $94 a customer. When I worked for Dish Network, I will turn this on its other head. There's resellers for somebody like Dish Network or DirecTV. And what they get is, let's say, $300 a new customer. So if I sign up new customers and I sign that service up with DirecTV, that reseller gets $300. If your cost of client acquisition is $310, you have a big problem, don't you? Is everybody kind of tracking what I'm saying here? What does it cost you versus what the lifetime value is? They only get a one-time $300. So their cost of acquisition is, it cannot be $310. So it needed to get knocked down to much lower than that. So you need to, this is why this screen is, what is the lifetime value of that customer? What does that customer bring in? And what did it cost you to get that customer? For LED Spot, there is no cost, because I own the company, so I don't charge for the SEO services. So therefore, and we don't run any ads. So when I put those two items together, there is no cost for client acquisition on this particular company. But that's a very rare circumstance, if that makes sense. Every one of you need to look at what it's costing you to get a customer. And then you have to decide what the limiters you want. Is it closing a deal? Is it getting the lead? What is that delimiter that you want to apply to it? Well, this kind of helps you kind of do that. So I just, what is the lifetime value per user? And do they come back? Do they buy over? Do they, I will say the residential people, they don't come, when they do come back, they come back usually a year or two later. I don't have them in and out of a turnstile on a regular basis. I suppose at some point I need to consider how to do that. But then again, how many parking lots a year are you putting in? So I guess that's the other sort of question. Or how many times a year do you put in a tennis court, or, you know, something along those lines. So everybody should be looking at cost of client acquisition, especially now. And the freer that acquisition level is, the happier you all should be. So that's that. That's the lifetime. Anybody got a question? Go ahead, Virginia.
I do. How do those figures get in that lifetime value?
All right. So on mine, it's using, and I haven't programmed it all the way through, but it's using the sales that the website's made. Remember, it's only tracking over the last little bit here. See, it's only 1 week of acquisition. It's not.
Okay.
All right. So actually, it's giving me a little bit longer, but you have to, this one has a monetary tracker on it because it's a sale. So you come to the website, you buy a light pole, you've made a sale.
Okay.
So that's how it's doing it. For you, you need to sit down and figure out all your channels and then divide over how many sales you have. And I would do that year to date. So you have an idea of what are you spending? When was a really good year? And when, you know, where are you at now on that? Because ideally what you want to do is, let me say this a different way. I have a difference of opinion with my CFO. If my CFO had their way, we would be at zero spend for anything. So, but I understand what she's trying to do. She's trying for me not to go cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs and go buy every membership in the world that I can and bite off more than I can chew. So I appreciate what she's doing. On the other side of the coin, her and I come up with a difference of opinion on that. But what I will say to you is that as you do this, you have to figure out how much money do you spend and where do you get the money back from? Where does it come from? At one point we were talking about these classes. What is the cost to do the class? Well, there's my time. Michael, what do I do to work on Michael's website? Because there's Michael involved in this, and what is our cost? So what is the cost of the class versus what do we get back out of that class over time? So that's one thing, that's one arm, networking functions for my company. For your company, I would have to say that you have a big pile of stuff everywhere, from signs to billboards to magazine or newspaper ads. At one point, you were investing in the website. You have the stuff with HAR, which the verdict in my mind is still out on how much that actually brings in. I have a lot of reasons for that. But So what is all that cost? And then how many houses do you sell? What's the net that you take off of that? So you want to start to understand what your cost is. So, and everybody should understand that. I mean, and if you don't, you need to. You need to know what you're doing, what works and what doesn't work, and what your spend is. And I dare to say probably 3/4 of this room have no clue what their cost for client acquisition is. So I almost want to say, everybody put your hand up that knows what it is. And I bet you we only have one or two of you that actually do it. So is that, go ahead. Who knows what their cost for client acquisition is? Anybody? Okay. Byron, you're the only, you? All right. So Byron's the only one. And guess what Byron does for a living?
What?
He's an accountant. So that's my opinion of why Byron knows the answer to that question, because Byron's an accountant. So, and I don't mean that like I'm picking on Byron. I mean, I just letting you guys know that, hey, this is why this is what it is, and why it's that way. So let me put this over here so I can see who's got what going on here. Oh, you know what, guys, I'm not reading the scroll great. So just let me know if you have a question. It's probably much better for you to do it that way than it is for you to put it in a chat, because I'm not reading the chats. Okay. Let's keep onward and upward with this. Okay, so I kind of know what mine is. I'm going to skip that because it's in beta. All right. Audiences. Do I have an audience? Do I have an audience built out? Obviously, I don't have that because I don't have ads on this one, so I don't have that. But I find this to be very helpful to me. This is one of the most helpful sections of what I think our website is. Now, I'm a lighting company. What you would think right out of the box, that our age group is male, right? That because they're construction workers for the most part. And that they're in the 25 to 35 age group, according to this chart I'm looking at. So what does that tell me? Anybody want to give me some ventures on what my first thought is when I get your base customers 25 to 35 and they're male?
Who are you going to target?
Well, it is who I'm going to target. But what do I have to do differently with that age group? Anybody want to take a shot? Anybody in the room under 35? Probably
no.
Lance is. Lance, you're under 35, aren't you?
No, I wish. I'm 37.
Okay. I'm going to use you because I guess we don't have anybody else that age group. Okay. What is your first thought when you go to a website?
What my first thought is when I go to a website?
Yeah, when you start into it. So thought process.
I'm looking at just how easy it is to navigate and if there's any kind of fun, I guess, videos or pictures.
Okay. What about the price on a website?
I would like to have that easily accessible.
And you want to feel like you're getting a deal?
Absolutely.
Okay. So the reason I don't mean to prime his questions and pull them out of him, but I know that 35 and under age group is primed for, they need to feel like they're getting a deal. That website better look slick. It better be easy to use. And I better make sure I know exactly what I'm getting, because if I don't, I'm not buying from you. Is that a fair assessment?
Yep.
Okay. That's a different, Byron, I'm going to call on you now to say, do you have that same criteria for a website, or do you kind of evaluate it a little bit differently?
In terms of who's coming?
Yeah. Well, and how do you use it? Because you're in an older segment.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. I hadn't looked at this in a while on my site, but my breakdown was 25 to 34 and 57.6% women.
So you have a big split between your age groups, don't you?
Yeah. I was surprised it's higher toward the younger.
Well, but I'm asking you too though. Are you more apt to dig through something to find the answer, or are you just, I'm in, I'm out. If I can't get what I want, I'm out of here.
No, I, you know, looking at this here made me think, you know, if I got more younger people coming to my site, I need to make sure I'm more appealing to them. You know what I mean?
That's exactly where I'm going. So when I see this, I need to have a much younger viewpoint in my head about what my website does and how my, because again, keep in mind, my overriding principle in all this is I have a 0.75 conversion number. That's bad. Okay. So if I have a 0.75 conversion number and I know that 70% of my traffic is under the age of 35, I better be making this look like it's for a 35-year-old and not like a 60-year-old.
Right.
All right. So that's why you want to know this. Age and gender are there. So here's the next one I can go down. And the thing is, I think most of us don't actually look at this kind of stuff to see where we go and what we do. So the next thing we're going to look at is, what are the interests of these people? You know, Google's tracking everybody based on their, you know, who they are and what they do. So according to this, I have a lot of do-it-myselfers, home and garden people, that kind of people coming to this website. Not sure why we have banking and financing, although that seems to be a little bit odd to me.
Ben, I have a question.
Go ahead.
I'm going through my site right now, and I had to actually turn on or enable demographics. I guess it wasn't turned on before.
Okay.
Does that mean that I'm not going to have any of this? Because on my interest, I don't show anything right now.
It's because it hasn't populated. They'll start to get it to populate. Okay.
Okay.
So just the in-market sub, the in-market, it means, you know, what, that this is more of a professional side of it. I don't know that I necessarily believe that employment is the biggest segment that we have coming to this website, but okay, if they say so. What is the time frame? Okay, it still is over a month.
I will share this with you. I'm looking at the in-market segment on mine. And, you know, a while back, I started, like on my LinkedIn, I started sharing more stuff for real estate investors and real estate professionals.
So you now have more of those people showing up, huh?
11% of real estate properties for sale, 10.49% for pre-owned houses, 9.8% for real estate residential properties.
Yeah.
That's about 35.
Because you're kind of going and reaching for those segments when you go after and you target it. So in other words, what you're doing is validating that the target that you use, you actually came back to, and it's actually been successful.
Okay.
So that's a good thing. Language, I'm going to tell you, my base language usage question is, what language are people using? If they're this is in their browser. What I'm going to say to you is, if you have a lot of people from China or North Korea, please call your web hosting company, because you probably have a hack somewhere. Unless you do business with those kind of those countries. But I never would want to see a high number or percentage of India or China on my website, because that means there's a leak somewhere. So just kind of put that in your, unless that's your niche.
What would you look for that?
Right under geography. Geography, language, and geography, location. We already looked at the location it is. Like, look, so I got United States, 75%, Canada, then India, then Australia. I'm going to say 200 people out of 8,000 from India, I'm not worried about. 161 from China, I'm not worried about. These are people trying to walk the internet. You know, I doubt very highly I have a whole bunch of people looking for light poles in China. What they're probably trying to do is find out if we would buy their light poles from them. Is that, you understand the difference in what I'm saying on that? That they're not looking to buy something from me. They want me to buy from them. But 161 does not a hacker make. What I will say is that China, India, North Korea, South Korea, the Asian Pacific Rim is terrible. So if you see a disproportionate amount of those, let somebody know, because chances are you have a problem. That's not why this report is there, but that's how Beth uses the report.
Beth, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay. I was going to ask, at what point do people's interests influence you? Like, would that have an impact on if you're doing stuff with Pinterest and house and stuff, the type of tags you add, or do you go to the point of actually rethinking the images? I saw there was a lot of people with interest in home and garden. Would you, after doing that analysis, consider changing photos, changing the actual copy on the site? Or
if the website's ranking, you're never going to get me to agree to change copy. But I wouldn't be afraid to. So let's say, let's give this, you're asking a really good question. So home and garden, we have a lot of landscape lighting, especially this time of year. We get a lot of people coming and looking for landscape lighting. I would put pictures of homes with landscape as opposed to a picture of a landscape lighting unit. So you would want to see a house lit up at night. You might want to see what those spotlights look like on the path light. What are they? So depends on where we're at. But here's what I do know. I still have 70% of my people are men. And I bet you if you ask this people in the room, they don't care how pretty something is for the most part. I mean, we may have a pretty person, but I don't know that we're going to have too many of them. So I have to look that, balance that out against my usership as to whether I'm going to adjust or not and how I'm going to adjust. Now, if I have a whole bunch of men that are looking for landscape lighting, chances are they're going to be looking for the wiring and the housing and what it looks like, not how pretty it makes it on the wall. Is that kind of, you understand what I'm saying? The difference, we don't, because we only have a 30% women usership on this website.
Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome. All right. Let's go onward and upward. So behavior, new versus returning. I want to know, on something like this, do I have a program to get people to come back to us? And if I don't, do I want to go ahead and invest in one? Now, I want to show you something here, and I'll tell you why this is this way. See, we have new visitors, and the new visitors, according to this, generated this. And the returning visitors generated this. It's not correct because Zandra, the lady that works for me, is the one processing the orders. What I really need to do is actually go in and knock her out of the statistics on this website. Because they look like it's returning visitors coming with 59 orders, but she's processing the orders, so it's really not the truth. Does everybody get why I'm saying that, I hope?
Yeah.
So I need to look at whiting, you know, whiting her out and getting her off this website so that we can get a more accurate representation here. What this also implies to me, though, in talking through this, is that we have a lot of people that order from us that need help to order and cannot order themselves. So what can I do to change that and make this be a more self-service type of a situation and less of a hands-on situation that she actually has to place those orders? Where is that? So that's going to be a question when we come out of the pandemic that I'm going to ask her is, what is that? Because look, this says we've had four orders that Zandra did not process from March the 8th to April the 7th. So why is that? Where did that come from? And that's what's pulling my conversion rate down, because you can see I've had 0.0 of a thing. Okay, so who's ever cleaning their dishes, do me a favor, mute yourself so we don't hear you. Okay. Let's see, returning, frequency of return. These numbers are all going to be a little screwed up because of her. So we'll have to figure out at some point. I'll have to solve that one. Technology, again, it tells me what is the end user using. The thing is that if they're using a desktop, my website's optimized for it. If you have a Tommaso with his trips to Italy, he has a website that a lot of people use mobile more than they use a computer, a desktop. So with that said, I need to make sure the conversion and the conversion action on that website on his phone works better and is clear and that people know what to do so that I can fix that conversion rate for them. Mobile is mobile, cross devices is, if you came in, do you overlap? Did you start on a desktop and move to a laptop? Is there, there's not a lot of overlap here. You see that, that they're not really coming in on a desktop and then moving to a mobile unit at a later date. So that, if that, if those, that did happen, these two sentence, these two circles would be laying over the top of each other. It's really important to know about your user in this day and age. At least that's my opinion. I think if you don't know and don't understand the psychology of your end user, your rate of conversion drops dramatically. I think you have to look all of those over. I know we always talk about putting a conversion action on a page and putting information on a page. We talk about all of that on a very frequent basis. However, when we decide that, I shouldn't say when we decide, if we don't take the proper steps to understand our user and then make changes to accommodate them, then you end up with a website with a 0.75 conversion rate. So I'm going to have to, at some point in my spare time, which I don't really have a lot of these days, sit down and figure out what do I have to change on this to make this more amenable to men, more amenable to men that are 25 to 35, and what am I going to do to increase their participation in this website? So I'm going to have to sit down and really put my thinking cap on it. So that's why it's very important to know who your user is. The next thing I'm going to talk about here is the acquisition function. What I want to say is that any of you that have Google My Business, those statistics are not here. There is a way to bring them in here. I'm still having Charlie write that out for me. And once I get it, then I'll tell everybody how to do it. But the actual Google My Business is not in your actual acquisition totals. So if you have a business that runs mostly off of Google My Business, your numbers are going to be much lower on the acquisition portion of this, as well as even the overall traffic. I have some people that have 16 and 18,000 visitors because of Google Maps. But if you come in analytics, it doesn't have anybody. So we'll just kind of throw that out as a side curve to you. But what I use this screen for is so that I understand what and where people are coming from, because that's very important to me to actually understand that. So, with that said, I kind of go down this, I look through this. I don't necessarily leave the overview screen. When I look at this, I come down into my search console and I look at the landing pages, because I want to know in the landing pages, what are the most trafficked, what is site is getting the most most amount of impressions, what page is getting the most amount of click-throughs. So this is interesting. My commercial landscape lighting page, it's getting 19,000 impressions a month. It's got less than a 1% on a click-through rate. So how many times does Google show the page? How many times did the end user click on the page? What is the percentage on that? And if you look, Google says the average position on that is 39. So it's not, I think it comes up more than it then. It being in position 39, to be honest with you. I just don't know that I know how to prove that at the moment. But okay, so let's come back over here. I'm trying to make my screen a little bit bigger so we can, it's like got it cut off for some reason. I don't know, what is it doing? What are you doing, Mr. Google? Let me see if I change that and come back, if it goes away and fixes it. Yeah. Okay. If you notice, these Search Console numbers are much higher than the regular website numbers. I don't know if you've all noticed that, but that's going on too. The next thing I have is the LED landscape lighting and the LED color temperature guide. That one's getting a lot of views. It's getting some click-throughs. Again, it's lowering the click-through rate. So I'm going to sort this. I usually sort by several different things. What is the click-through rate and what is my impressions? So I've had 500,000 impressions on this website. These are searches. And this is the list by impressions. This is the list by clicks. Okay, so just kind of turn these things around so you know, hey, I have this. This is how many clicks I got. I would say, again, I'm back to this stupid basketball page. And not that the page is stupid, but you understand what I'm saying. I'm back to the basketball page. At 400, it's got a 5% click-through rate. It's at 7,000 views, 445. I don't think we have sold the basketball court. And this thing kind of tells me we haven't. So, yeah, I need to go look at the basketball court page and see what I can do to help make sales on the basketball court page. Transformer parts, another one, 12,250. My click-through rate is reasonable. No sales. And then we have this one, which what is the fixture EPA wind rating guide? I don't expect sales on this page. I have a 12% click-through rate on it. It doesn't come up a great grand deal of the time, but I also have zero sales on it. I wouldn't expect it, so I'm going to throw that one right out. But I go through each and every one of these landing pages to see what's coming in, what changes do I need to make, what adjustments do I need to make, and what can I do to help bring a customer in on a website. When they see it. So, and it may be that if I go look in Google, the write-up is not all that good either. So there is that part of it. The other thing is I don't care about query countries and devices. The next thing I'm going to tell you I care about is the queries, which are the search strings that Google will give me that tell me what people are using to put in our website. This has had over 17,000 query strings applied to it. Okay, so you can see, what I will tell you is that 50% of all web searches are never repeated, that they're unique to the end user. So that what you put in a computer and what I put in a computer to get to the end of the web, to get to somebody's website, they may be two completely different ways to look at it. I may talk to like Yoda and say my sentences backwards, you may say sentences forward. You may say shoes red, and I may say red shoes. So those, the 50% of all web searches are unique to the end user. So we need to make sure we're shooting with the biggest water gun possible. If you notice, I have 17,000 separate terms. That's the ones that they've identified and they're even gonna let me know about. There's probably another 40 or 50,000 that they won't even tell me about. But display case lighting, applications of a light dimmer circuit, that's a home user guy. Batting cage lights are somebody looking for to make a purchase of battery, arena lights, basketball court lighting. Those are all words that people are using to find us to go buy whatever those are. Because you're not just going to go randomly put in the word basketball court lighting, I wouldn't think. At least that would be my guess. Cheap horse arena lighting. So I can see that the user intent on each and every one of these is pretty much some type of a sale. And this is said like commercial landscape lights. I'm going to go and find out where that page goes, what it looks like, what can I do, and what can I do to make that page work better for my. So you need to go and review every one of these queries and see what you can do to make sure that those queries are optimize user intent based on what the page is that the website serves. What I will tell you is that I do make decisions every day, because if I have a page that's ranking on pole lights, I'm going to be less likely to make a change to that page because it's ranking on something like pole lights. But if I have a cheap horse arena lighting, horse arenas, that word's a lot simpler to get ranked on, I may make some adjustments to that page to help increase my sales. So you always have to make a decision on what do you want to change, what can you improve, how can you improve it, and then what does that all look like. What I will tell you is at some point, if we're stuck in pandemic hell, I probably will do a conversion class. I had intended to do it. Oh, I think I thought I was going to do it this month and we were going to do it at Tech Space. So I'm not doing it this month because I'm trying to, but I will try to get a conversion class scheduled. Like, where do you have to position things? How do I match user intent? What do I need to do to make sure that I'm addressing things? And I know myself that on this LED spot site, there's a lot of things that could be done better to help increase conversion. So,
of course, on like on queries, like when I click on that and I even go back a year, 2 years, nothing populates online.
Well, it's because you didn't set your Search Console up.
Oh, I got you.
You have to link Search Console to this or it doesn't show up.
Okay. So
that's a big deal.
Okay.
All right. If I was running Google AdWords, those words appear here. And then here's some of the networks and referral networks I'm getting any social traffic off of. I know that we do relatively nothing on local search. Are on, not local search, on social media. So therefore, I wouldn't anticipate anything being here. So I'm kind of surprised that I got 38 from Pinterest. So I'm going to kind of look at that later. All right. So that's the acquisition tree. The next one is the behavior tree. The behavior tree is an interesting tree. It tells me how people behave on the website. This is one of my most favorite things that you can see, which is where people come in from, where they go to, what their next click is, and then where do they go when they leave. I've always liked this report and it's always kind of fascinated me. I did flip this out to WordPress. So what I'm going to need to do at some point is go in and put the WordPress funnel in so it shows up right. But you can see, so these people come into the homepage, where do they come to? And then it tells me how many people drop off along the way. You know, 8,100 come in, 5,400 of my people drop off the start page. So they never go to a second page, never. So we have to figure out what are we gonna do to try to get them to move to a second page and do something different. What I will say is this, is that the ones that come in without a mission are the ones that tend to fall off more. So if you look at this power calculator, when somebody comes in on the power calculator, 91% of the people drop off on that. The reason why is because they come in, they read the power calculator, they use the power calculator and they leave. So because they were looking to do specifically what that page said rather than just whatever. So there's that story. All right, so let's see what else we've got here. You can continue to add steps to it too, so you can kind of see what they want to do and how many. See, so this is kind of telling me too. So if you look, if you come over here, right, we've got the where they start from. I'm trying really hard.
Hey, Beth, real quick question. What does it mean where it says, like 100 more pages? I have one that says 9 more pages, 10 more pages. What does that mean at the bottom?
Where? Here?
Interaction?
Oh, yeah, okay. So there was 100 other pages. Like on this one, there's 100 other pages. These are the top 5. There was 100 more pages that were involved that. So there's they not really truly 100. There's 421, 3 other pages that were involved in this. So when you kind of go to here, it will give you that. If you go here, it's giving me a hard time. It does. See how it's changing? It's giving me the, what are these pages? It tells me who those, what those other pages are. But the thing is, until you fix these pages, I wouldn't worry about these pages. That's at least my opinion of that. All right. Is that, are you cool with that? You understand what I'm saying on that?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. All right. That's the one thing. It doesn't show me your smiley little faces. I don't know if you all just went anti-camera today on me or what, but if I don't recognize your voice, I don't know who you are. That's not fair.
I thought you had the cameras off because I think I had mine on.
Well, you have a picture. You don't have a camera, but you have a picture. At least you have a picture, and Nancy has a picture.
Yeah, but I have a camera too, though. I thought you had the camera set to on.
I do have it set to on. I don't see you, though.
No, I thought you had it set to off.
No, I have them set to on because I want to see who's in. I would love to know who you are because some of you I know on site and I don't know your voices like that. So it helps me to know who's in a room. So you, I just happen to know your voice. You have a very distinct voice after 10 years.
Yeah, see, when I logged in, it didn't give me the option for the camera option.
It didn't? All right, I'll have to see if I can update those sentences that for the next one then, because I would like to see who the heck's here.
Okay.
All right, so site content, it gives me the content drill down on the pages. That's another important function of all of this. So I come in, I go to my commercial lighting page, I click on the commercial lighting page, and it gives me all the pages that it drills down to. So when I go to that, when I land on the commercial lighting page, 2,500 of those people went to the athletic sports field lighting page. And then they went to the tennis court lighting. So I have tennis courts first, horse arena second, batting cages third, so on and so forth down the list. So I keep getting more and more people, or more and more drill down on each one of these. If I go to tennis courts, you see, I can go to lighting for tennis courts, photometrics drawings, or back to the homepage. And it gives me the content drill down on every single one of these pages, which to me is a really, 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 really big deal. And I've got to go. So you can also tell what are the biggest exit pages. Guess what's the biggest exit page? We are back. Thank you. We are back to basketball. So again, so if I walk out of anything with this class, I'm going to tell you I'm walking away that basketball is one of the biggest problems on this website. That if I could pin this down a little bit, I may start to make some sales on basketball court lighting because I see a lot of problems. It's my top exit page. It's my entry page. It's people are not buying from it page. We have a really big problem with basketball. Now, it may be that basketball's canceled, but I doubt it. I'm being funny. All right. I can't help these things. Okay. The next thing is site speed. And this is a big deal. I'm going to tell you to use G-metrics. It says the average load time on this website is about 9.21, which doesn't surprise me because of how big the database is on this. I would tell everybody to use G-metrics to see how fast your website is. Know what its problems are. Know if it's, I'm going to tell you right now, I expect this to fail because it doesn't have a cache on it. And we have to move it to a caching server with a Lightspeed cache on it so that, and I did this wrong. I did the wrong URL. Let me do this right. So I expect this to fail because it has no cache on it. We're trying to get to a point where we can migrate it and move it over. It's on the list of things to do, but it's not hurting it too bad. But I want to just kind of make sure that we understand what I'm talking about here with this. I expect an F just, yep, okay. Because if you notice, the very first thing it says is browser cache is a big problem. A lot of JavaScript running it. I think we're going to find out the images on this website are really big too, which at some point I probably need to fix. But yeah, see, here's all the images that are having problems that they want to have me compress. So I expected this. This is not to be unexpected. Then when I put the browser cache in there, it will make all these items improve and it will make this go away. But understand what your website's doing. Understand what your page speed is. Understand why you're having a problem. Understand all of it, okay? Because it's going to be one of those things, you know, if you do enough things right, you start to get your page to move up and it'd be a whole lot better than if you didn't. So just to know that, let me close this. Okay. This is the timing per page, the load speed per page. It gives you a breakout of what pages are, what they're doing, how they're doing. Load page load per page, and then if you wanted to put the bounce rate in, you could. The assumption is the longer the page takes to load, the higher the bounce rate. So that's what that assumption is. You notice everybody's green, so that's a good thing. And we've had no speakable bounce rate because of it. So we're in a good spot on that. Sorry, the dogs are making noise. I'm like hearing hiccups. I'm like, he's dreaming down there. All right, so if I go to speed suggestions, it's going to come out and it's going to give me some ideas of what I need to change here. At least it should. All right, so if I go to this LS calculator page, it gives me the ability to look in Google's webmaster tool or page site in speed. They say they don't use this anymore, but I got to tell you, I don't necessarily believe them. Because look, they just sent me over here. So if you look at this page, it kind of gives me what my issue is, which is all of this is because of no caching server. So you see all these little blank dots here. And then it tells me what I need to do to fix it on each one of them. Each one of them gives me a idea of what I need to do to fix it. This one here is particularly interesting because it's saying I have a 2 meg homepage. And it's because of scripts that are loaded in that. So I'm gonna have to go back and I'm gonna see. I took off the web chat off this website for the time being. I'm wondering if that's not one of the scripts that's there that's running that's driving this up like that. But one of the problems it's having is the scripts and the script requests on this page. So it gives you some ideas of what you need to fix, what you need to address, how do you address it. I know this has got a simple fix on my end. I just have to leave it, move it to a Lightspeed cache server and we're good. I think. Again with the HTTPS. I think this has a caching server on it. If we let it go ahead and fetch it, and all. It's taking it a minute, so let's kind of while we're waiting. Oh wait, here it comes. This one doesn't have a lot of browser caching. I gotta go tell Charlie about it. He's gonna tell me it's my live chat that's causing this to be a problem. That's what I think the last time I asked him, that's what he came back and told me, is that live chat pulls from a third party, and when it does, it screws up the site performance. So that's the kind of stuff that we need to look at. And then you have to decide, I'm keeping the chat. It's much more important to me to have a chat than it is to have a good score on G-metrics. So that's that. I think that's what he told me this was the problem. Yeah, see, look at SEMrush, live chat, Google. These are all the things that are slowing that page down. So you can see what it is. It's the social media shares. And he said, in order for him to fix that, I would have to shut all of them off. I'm not willing to do that. We're leaving it. Onward and upward is what I told them, forget about it. All right, site search. Want to go over the site search aspect of this. We don't have a site search, so therefore it's not showing up anything. And I don't have search pages in. I've often debated whether I should put something in that works like that. I don't know if there's enough value to it for me to screw with it. I'll get back to you on that one. The event manager is a big deal. If you put the code right on the event manager, you can tell where people are coming from, what they're doing, how deep they go. Do we have calls? Do they come in from? So you see all the different things that I have here. I have how many people, I have a bunch of different events that I've set up. So how deep did somebody go? What are the products? Do they go through the products? What is the cart? Do they email us? Some of them I have, do they phone us? I've put the phone link on there that you can link, hit the top of the phone. These are those events that it'll tell me what somebody's doing on the website and whether they're doing what I want them to do. So you guys should think about putting event codes on yours. There is a process to that. Maybe we'll have how to add an event code to a string session one day. Because there's extra code you have to put, like around the phone number, you have to put some things in there to trigger it. So that's a big deal. The other thing is, if you look here, if we go to pages, because again, it's great to have all this data. I want to know what's the biggest things that where we're having the biggest events from. And if you look here, the biggest, most unique is the bulbs, buying these halogen bulbs. And we sell more halogen bulbs than I ever can ever mention at this point in our life. So this has a high event total, simply because we sell a lot of halogen bulbs. Oh, by the way, here's the basketball court page again. So now I have to really think about what to do with this basketball court. I don't have AdSense set up. And last but not least on this is the conversion and the conversion goals. You can set up a goal. You can make a goal. Now, I had goals set up in this based on the old shopping cart. I've not come back in and added it, but I had a funnel based on the old shopping cart that each step of that funnel that it went through, it gave me credit for it. So I could see where people were falling out of my sales funnel. So what point I put them in from, what did I expect them to do? Where do I expect them to go? And where are they falling out? That's all really big information to know. The other thing I had as a goal was how many chats did we have? And I thought that was something that I considered that a chat meant that we kind of broke through enough that I was going to count that as a conversion, because I kind of felt like if somebody was going to contact us, then it's up to my sales staff. So we have a chat in there, we had an add to cart in there, and we had an entire sales funnel in there. So that's that story. I would make sure you set that up. And because I have the enhanced e-commerce on Monster Insights, you can see what we sold the most of. We sold 16 acorn globes. We've got a quart blade highlighter. We sold a bunch of those for 13,000. So everything that we sold in here is here listed on this report. And it tells me how many we sold and what our most popular items are. So I kind of always felt like that was an important thing. That was something that we've been missing. What is that? The other thing here is that I have, they came in and they didn't shop. So 85% did not shop at all. I had a whole pile else that viewed products and didn't shop at all. Then I had about 50% of those people that abandoned their shopping cart. And what I did on the abandoned shopping carts now is I put some software in that if they put stuff in their shopping cart, I actually am out within 10 minutes offering them a discount. And within inside of 3 days, I'm offering another discount. So I actually have discounts going out to people based on what they what their cart is, so that any abandoned cart we try to recapture. And that was based on this report here that I could see that that's what was happening. So that was a big deal. I would make sure that you have if you're running a store, make sure you're running some kind of abandoned cart software on it. I think that's a big deal. You can kind of see we've got checkout behavior. It tells me who checked out, who did what. We had 27 people put stuff in their cart and they dropped off. So we need to go figure out why did they drop out of there? These are what is my best product. So that's a big deal, which of course is the acorn light. This is our performance based on SKU and transaction ID. So we can kind of see what somebody bought one-on-one. And then did they order with a coupon or not? And I don't know that we did. Because I don't think I set the product coupon up to report to analytics, which I know I didn't. So long story short is there's a lot of information that's valuable here. The other thing I'm going to tell you, and I'm going to, let me see if I can back out of this and get to this. Google Data Studio, everybody should start to look at. I probably at some point need to look at giving a class in just this. But the data studio and Google Tag Manager are two other things that I actually had hoped to get to Google Tag Manager today, but I don't think I am going to. There's a lot of people that went and made reports and that you can go ahead and pull and get a copy of it based on whatever the sample data is. So I can go to, I think this one will populate, I think. No, this is not a, this is a template file. I had one set up that was a permanent file. Hold on a minute. Let me just put use this one. This one's, let me see if this one actually works. Okay, so this is the one that belongs to Trips to Italy. As you would imagine, it's severely off on traffic because nobody wants to go to Italy right now. But you see this nice little report it was able to put together for me that I can see what my users are, what my sessions are, you know, what did I want to use as the data set. I can take any website on this list and pull it through. So let me see if I can pull it. LED spot in here. I think I can. So it will allow you to take some of this data and make it into usable reports that you have. And then there's actually templates that are already created. So you can make your own data template if you want. You can borrow one. You can, like this one here. Let me see if this one, if I can set it. I think that's what we're just looking at. Hold on. Let's see what this one looks like. It's going to make me do too much. But the moral of the story is you can go through, you can make charts, you can make graphs. It depends on what you like. If you like numbers, it'll do it for you. I have one. I'm trying to find it. I have one here. Here. Okay. Let me see if this will work. So this is just one based on, this is a free template that we got that's just based on Google traffic. So I would encourage everybody to play around with Data Studios because you can make whatever port you want and output it and pull it back in and make it work that way. So that's a, it's a handy, nifty little tool. It's a good way for me, like for me, I'll put together a report sometimes and I'll pull it back out and pull it over to give a customer if I need to. It's just a nice, neat little way to go ahead and do that here. Let me see if this one, see like this one's branded. This one gives me, this gives me all the information that I need. And let me, see, it gives me the query strings, what was the page title. So I can kind of look at this and see what's performing and what's not. So that's the kind of stuff that you need to look at. It gives me, so what kind of report do you want? What do you want to do with it? How do you want it to work? And what do you want it to do? So that's that story. So we have come to yet another day, end to another fun excursion into this. I will tell you, I'm doing LinkedIn tonight through SCORE and through HCC. There's 344 people registered. So if any of you want to attend, you can go to the SEO 411 class page, which is that internetmarketinghouston.com, and go sign up and register because we have a 500 people cap. So right now we've got, at last count, we had 344. They seem to just be pouring in the door. So I don't know that we're going to have all 300 people in there, but we'll just see how it goes. But otherwise, this is it for today. Does anybody have any questions or anything that they want to cover before we head out for today?
A quick question. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
a quick question about these reports. How do you send them to your clients? Do you share, when you share, do they get them via Google Drive or how?
No, you just send it. It's a simple download. It's just a download, output, download.
And it's a PDF or?
Yeah, it sends it out as a PDF or a web page.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much.
No, you're very welcome. What other questions we have?
Nothing on here. Thank you, Beth. We'll see you later.
Okay, Byron, take care, bud. I'll see you next time, okay? Oh, wait, somebody's blinking up here at me. Hold on.
Thanks, Beth.
You're welcome, Lance. I'll see you soon.
That's good.
Hopefully sometime.
Yeah.
Take care. I miss you guys.
Miss you too.
So, all right. I'll see you guys next time. Thank you and have a good day.